In this episode of Cycling Tours, I will explore how you can commute using the cycling network of Taman Jurong. Hey everybody, Transit Evolution here, and welcome to the first ever episode of Cycling Tours, a brand new video series featuring cycling infrastructure in Singapore on a town-by-town basis. These videos will feature me pedaling systematically through the cycling path network, and occasionally the park connector network, as exhaustively as possible within each cycling town, starting from and ending at a major transport node, like a MRT station, Lakeside in the case of Taman Jurong. There are quite a lot of different objectives which I hope to achieve in this video series. For one, I hope to show that it is practical to use active mobility devices as a means to solve the last mile problem in your commutes. In the process, I will also be reviewing the current cycling infrastructure in place in the cycling town for the video in question. The strengths, opportunities, weaknesses and constraints. Finally, I hope to explore a little bit about the history and geography of each town's planning and design, and highlight interesting features along the way. To avoid boring you, these videos will be played back at twice the real-time speed. For this video, I will start by going depth first in this cycling network rather than breadth first, traversing to the southern end of this estate along the main roads, while skipping the paths along the streets within the estate of Taman Jurong. This is to provide some quick estimations on how long it would take for you to get between the MRT station and whatever amenities are along the way, or you know, your home, should you be living within this housing estate. Three roads run through Taman Jurong in the north-south direction: Corporation Road along the western flank, Yuan Ching Road along the eastern flank, and Corporation Drive right down the center. So I suppose it would be fitting to cycle southwards along Corporation Road first, then northwards along Yuan Ching Road later, before traversing the network systematically. I'm now at the intersection of Corporation Road with Corporation Drive and Chin Bee Drive, which has a dedicated traffic face for all southbound vehicles to move through. For whatever reasons, car traffic seems to have signal priority over pedestrians here, although there are no traffic conflicts, resulting in a needless wait. Since the southwards journey is still rather long, I guess it is good time for a brief background of this estate. Taman Jurong, originally Jurong Town Neighbourhood 1, is quite special in that it is one of four neighbourhoods in the original Jurong Town that was built by the Jurong Town Corporation from 1969 to 1982, together with Boon Lay Gardens, Teban Gardens and Pandan Gardens. With Taman being gardens in Malay, all four neighbourhoods are named after the Jurong Lake Gardens they surround, a stark contrast from the industrial heartlands of the Jurong Industrial Estate on the west, where the residents here would go and work. So, why the emphasis on gardens? It's worth keeping in mind that back then, Singapore was a lot less developed, and Singapore the city as we know today, is much smaller than Singapore the island. So Jurong Town couldn't just be another satellite town like Queenstown or Toa Payoh. It had to be a completely separate settlement, like Woodlands at the time, as it was so isolated from the city that Jalan Ahmad Ibrahim was the only road link in the vicinity to it. Since residents cannot easily travel to the city, Jurong Town had to be completely self-sufficient with all amenities, and be not just a place to live and work, but to play, for thousands of people to be convinced to move to such distant land, which was initially devoid of everything, resulting in the development of recreational amenities like Jurong Lake Gardens. Eventually in 1982, JTC handed over the management of these housing blocks to the Housing and Development Board, which was by then developing the new Jurong East and Jurong West new towns further up north. The old Jurong town was administratively split into two along Jurong Lake, with Taman Jurong and Boon Lay Gardens becoming part of Jurong West new town, and the other two becoming part of Jurong East new town. Since the 1990s, neighbourhood renewal has taken place in this estate, and many old JTC era blocks have since been demolished and rebuilt into HDB precincts. As seen from the block numbering of the newer blocks, the once large neighbourhood has since been split into two smaller ones. Neighbourhood 1 forms the southern half of Taman Jurong, while neighbourhood 3 forms the northern half. After travelling the length of Corporation Road, I would say that the cycling path here is pretty alright by Singapore standards, with my only pet peeve being it occasionally alternating between the segregated and shared path configurations. As for this intersection with Yang Ho Road and Jalan Tukang where I turn left, work is currently ongoing to widen the road with turning lanes, and for some reason that results in the obstruction of the footpath, so that will be a problem for now. Anyways, now that I've reached Yang Ho Road, I've got a good estimate that it takes 12 minutes to travel across Taman Jurong along Corporation Road. This is rather competitive to taking bus services 49, 98, 154, 240 or 246 from Lakeside MRT station, which would take about 11 to 12 minutes, even excluding wait times. Well, you may have noticed at this point that many of the intersections in this estate come with slip lanes that are built in a manner resulting in really tiny traffic islands, and some of them may become a problem during peak hours, as there's very little room for pedestrians and cyclists to wait for the traffic light. Ideally, these slip lanes should have been removed in such instances. Moving on, next to the public housing project Yang Ho Spring 1, the cycling path abruptly turns black and diverges from the footpath, going up and down an unnecessary slope. A telltale sign that this path is built to an older design standard. I'll talk about how that came to be later in the video, but here the cycling path abruptly ends. I'm not sure why that happened, and unfortunately that means that the Akape on my left and Super Bowl Jurong on my right is served by very narrow footpaths. To be fair, Super Bowl doesn't exactly scream pedestrian friendly, with a substantial open-air car park right next to the bowling alley and supermarket, but I would have liked to see this little gap in the cycling network closed to make alternative transport options here more comfortable. Now along Yuan Ching Road, the shared path returns, and with that I will make my journey northwards back to Lakeside MRT station. Perhaps an interesting fact about Taman Jurong is that, unlike the utilitarian numbered names of streets in most new towns of its era, many of the streets here were named in reference to either the views that the Chinese and Japanese gardens provide, or the hopes and aspirations for this then industrial town to be long-lasting. For example, we are on Yuan Ching Road, Yuan Jing Lu in Mandarin, which means garden view, and here I cross Yong Kuang Road, Yong Kuang Lu in Mandarin, which means Forever Bride. This is where I encounter quite a huge informal crossing that has been set back here. This is a treatment that was done in late 2021 together with the cycling path to make Yong Kuang Road slightly easier to cross. It comes with pinch points and a central island treatment enabling slightly easier two-stage crossings for this four-lane street, even though the lanes are still pretty wide. This informal crossing at Tah Ching Road is especially problematic. For whatever reasons, there's a short queue of vehicles here, waiting for gaps in the traffic along Yuan Ching Road to make their turns, even during off-peak hours when I was recording this video. So you can expect as a pedestrian or cyclist to wait a long time before the queue disappears, for you to cross the street. This results in delays to active mobility users that add up and make commuter cycling on these paths less viable. Observant people will see a problem with this path along this part of Yuan Ching Road. It is substandard to substandard standards. The Singaporean standard for commuter facilities calls for a 1.5 meters footpath directly adjacent to a 2 meters cycling path to accommodate a person walking, a person on a wheelchair, and two bicycles at the same time. But even then, they have to move in an almost perfectly straight manner. Here though, the pavement is suspiciously narrow for what it's trying to do. I did the measurements and it seems like they are trying to fit 3.5 meters of stuff into 3 meters. You get a 1.2 meter wide footpath, barely able to accommodate a single wheelchair, and a cycling path with the width of 1.8 meters, resulting in dangerously close passes. This makes it hard for people to use commuter facilities the way they are intended, even if they want to. I would not be surprised if pedestrians stray onto the cycling paths in such instances, and cyclists on the footpath. They simply have no other choice. I think the strange part about cycling along Yuan Ching Road is that the further north I go, the worse the provision for cycling gets. One would expect more persons on bicycle to use the network as you get closer to Lakeside MRT station. Given that the main idea behind such a cycling network design is to support a bike-train modal combination for longer distance commutes, which means that cycling infrastructure should actually get better, but instead it gets worse. This part around Yuan Ching Secondary School is the most suboptimal. Cycling paths end abruptly, leading not to bus stop bypasses, but straight into the middle of bus stops, and then ending again as we approach informal crossings. The pillars supporting the covered walkways aren't exactly helping either, creating many obstructions along the way. This final stretch along Boon Lay Way is also rather problematic. The commuting volumes will be the highest here, and yet a shared track configuration is used, resulting in a lot of pedestrian-cyclist conflicts, especially given the limited space for pedestrians waiting to cross the slip lane. They would have the space for this if the intersection wasn't widened to accommodate more cars back in 2014. But it is clear that claustrophobic shared tracks like this just aren't good enough for long-distance cycling commuters along Boon Lay Way, especially if the pain conveniently ends where the commuter volumes are the highest, right here. So, 13 minutes by Yuan Ching Road. I'll now make a turn to the left, onto this nameless pedestrian link. Come to think about it, it's a modal filter, but no one really thinks of it that way. I hope to legitimize this route by giving it a name. Lakeside Station Link. Along the link, you can see lots of parked bikes obstructing the passageway, a hint that commuter cycling is quite popular here, but there's a lack of bicycle parking at the MRT station. 526 lots just isn't enough for a population of 120,000 across the 5 neighbourhoods in the vicinity. The linkage weakens at this signalised crossing across Lakeside Drive, as for some reason the crossing is misaligned from the path on both sides. But once I reach Jurong Park Connector, I can finally get going. This park connector runs parallel to Sungai Lancha. There's one running parallel on the opposite side of this canal, and it is frequently used either for leisure or for people to commute on longer distances, westwards to Boon Lay, eastwards to Jurong East, and perhaps through some convoluted routing, to the city centre as well. On the opposite side, you may see a small little estate of landed housing, Lakeside Grove, and through it runs a footpath leading to Corporation Walk, a modal filter of sorts that allows pedestrians to have a shorter walk to Corporation Drive, but it will not be featured in this video. Now travelling next to Lake Point Drive, a driveway leading to Lake Point Condo, the first condominium built here by the JTC, and at this point the park connector is suspiciously narrower than before, while still staying segregated into walking and cycling lanes. But of course it all comes to an end here, as I reach Corporation Road. I will not bore you with what you have already seen before, so I shall speed up the video to 20 times the real-time speed each time this happens, until we reach the next fresh path segment. Up ahead along Corporation Drive, we encounter a slightly confusing intersection with Corporation Walk. You might think that this is a signalized intersection, but things just aren't what they seem here. Rather, we have a signalized crossing on Corporation Drive, followed closely by a left-in left-out junction to Corporation Walk. There's a signalized crossing on the left for Lakeside Primary School students, but I can use the informal crossing as well. Now I will have to make a crossing along Tah Ching Road, and we encounter a zebra crossing built in tandem with the cycling paths here. But it's set back really far back from the main road, necessitating a significant detour, especially for pedestrians. Supposedly such an arrangement makes it easier for drivers to see pedestrians, while also providing storage room for vehicles turning in to avoid obstructing vehicles heading straight. But given the long setback, what happens sometimes is that drivers will be accelerating after making their turns, and wind up still failing to give way to those using the zebra crossing. Now, being built in the early 1970s, the streets within Taman Jurong are built to more compact dimensions, but at T-junctions like this one with Tah Ching Road, informal crossings were often used instead of signalized or zebra crossings, inconveniencing pedestrians a lot. This is especially so back in the day, when a footpath was built between the motor carriageway and the planting verge, resulting in crossing points that were very far out, and hence, long crossing distances. With the construction of cycling paths, most of these pavements have since been shifted to the other side of the planting verge to cover roadside drains, as is common practice when building new roads nowadays. Thus, these informal crossings have been set back and made easier to cross. Still, it is important to keep a lookout for traffic in all directions, even in signalized intersections. The one I just passed through next to the neighbourhood centre not only allows for discretionary right turns, they must do it discretionarily as there's no dedicated signal face for them. Here we approach a condominium, a type of private housing in Singapore, and they come with fences for access control. This one by the name of Lake Life was built fairly recently with porous fences, so that cyclists can see residents coming in and out of the gate, preventing potential collisions along the bus stop bypass, though in this case it is a little too narrow. At this stage, I'm about to cross Yong Kuang Road, and unfortunately I have to cross Corporation Drive as well. Taman Jurong is one of the first cycling town in Singapore where almost every single street has a single cycling path on one side, which results in a relatively dense cycling network. But being on one side, it is all the more important to make up your mind on where the cycling path should run, whether it should be on the left or the right side of the road, to reduce the need for unnecessary crossings. The authorities did make up their mind for the other two north-south direction roads, but were unable to do so for this central one, so that will delay my journey a little. Having cycling paths on one side also means that cyclists living on the other side of the street have to cross the main street one more time to get to proper cycling infrastructure. Fortunately, Taman Jurong's street grid is rather dense and are made of streets of relatively small dimensions by Singaporean standards, making crossings rather easy to do, to get to the right side of the street that has a cycling path. I am now approaching the southern end of the estate. One thing worth noting about Singapore's cycling infrastructure is that they are made of bi-directional cycling paths. There's no such thing as wrong way riding. The joy of having bi-directional cycling paths is that sometimes you can have an unbelievably easy time making a right turn, completely unimpeded by traffic lights. Just look at that. I will now speed up the video as I make a beeline to start covering the smaller streets in the cycling network, mainly those running in the east-west direction, starting with Yong Kuang Road. Just after Corporation Tiara lays the cap of a semi-truck kinda obstructing pedestrians, but more importantly, an iconic Instagram-worthy landmark in Taman Jurong on the left. Four JTC-era housing blocks placed in the diamond formation, block 63-66 Yong Kuang Road. These 21-storey blocks were the tallest of their time, consisting of purely rental flats, which have since been vacated, though as of the time of this video's recording, the ground floor is still accessible. I think it is good to note that Taman Jurong cycling path network wasn't built all at once back in late 2021. In fact, it was initially meant to be completed by the end of 2015, using the old road typologies that sees grey cycling paths further from the carriageway than the footpath. But network completion didn't happen, and for a very long time the town wound up having a rather discontinuous cycling network, with the path I'm riding on being one of the segments. It was not until late 2021 when the cycling network of Taman Jurong was finally completed, with the new design standards calling for red cycling paths. 5.6 kilometers of cycling paths were launched in October that year, resulting in a robust 10-kilometer cycling network, connecting to Jurong Lake Cycling Town as well further in the northeast. Many of the existing segregated cycling paths were refined and repainted red in color, swapping positions with the footpath to be on the side closer to vehicular traffic, or converted to shared paths where space is lacking. However, along Yangsheng Road, a lot of imperfections in this path remains, arising from the laxer requirements of old path designs, with obstructions like lampposts and overground electrical boxes left standing in the middle, rather than cleared away. Right next to the neighbourhood centre, consisting of Taman Jurong Market, Food Court, Community Centre and Shopping Centre. Technically usable, but not ideal. We are now at this quirky left-in left-out junction once again, but this time I will make use of this bicycle crossing to get back to the correct side of Corporation Drive, so that I can turn into Yang An Road. Of course, I could have simply used the footpath on the other side. Footpath cycling is legal and often the only reasonable choice in Singapore after all. But motorized PMD users can't do that, so I will try to avoid footpaths as much as possible to have a more complete feeling of the cycling network. At this point, I would like to note that one strength of the cycling network in Taman Jurong is its topography, which is pretty flat. In fact, Yong An Road is probably one of the streets here with a steeper incline, being built around a short hill. That's not to say that the town is completely flat, you can feel a slight downslope towards the southern end of the cycling town, but it sure does make cycling in this estate, on normal bicycles, a lot more pleasant. Also, with narrower streets running through this part of town, you can see that there's quite a bit of pedestrians walking around, using their feet as a means of travel to the neighbourhood centre right across the street. And it is indeed a fairly fast-free experience to cross the street, since traffic volumes are low and there are no encumbrances like bushes and fences along the way. This is where I approach the junction with Corporation Drive, and we encounter something here that can't quite be seen on maps. Although there's a cycling path on the other side of Corporation Road, there's no way to ride across this junction, because there aren't curb cuts that lead to the other side of this road. Okay, well, technically there's a curb cut here, but you have to make a detour. Instead, the shared path continues by making a right turn, leading to what is probably the busiest bus stop in this neighbourhood, right next to the neighbourhood centre. I nearly had to dismount and push, but at least there's a narrow little bus stop bypass here. This is a short cycling path segment, which ends at this intersection, so I will have to make two crossings as I continue on to the next street segment that has yet to be covered. Tao Ching Road is just another small street in Taman Jurong, and the noteworthy thing about the cycling path here is two needless informal crossings across the pickup and drop-off point. Though routing the path behind this driveway could have caused other issues, so I digress. At this point, I'm along the last two streets with cycling paths yet to be covered in this video. Tah Ching Road here, which will be followed by Kang Ching Road later, named after the views of the pagoda and hills respectively in Jurong Lake Gardens that these streets are somewhat aligned to have a view of. These are newer paths and they are pretty straightforward to travel on. And I think that's the funny thing about this estate. The best paths are the ones that probably won't see that much cycling commuters. There's a new housing precinct here by the name of Lakeside View. Cycling infrastructure generally takes a slide near construction sites. For example, we have this temporary but nasty hump here. You definitely want to make sure you aren't pedaling when going over it, for your pedals could get caught by it. At this point in time, there's only one more cycling path remaining to cover before I would consider that the cycling network of Taman Jurong is fully traversed, but it's on the other side of Yuan Ching Road, which is quite a busy road. There's a few unsignalized junctions along this road, with missing crossings to promote smoother traffic flow, so I have to backtrack a little until this crossing. Perhaps on this last leg next to Lakeside Gardens, I would take this time to summarize the cycling infrastructure here. Generally, I would say that Taman Jurong has some of the finest infrastructure for intra-town cycling in Singapore at the moment. Granted, there's still quite a number of imperfections in the network and the infrastructure, which have been rightfully pointed out along this video, the informal crossings across junctions with huge corner radiuses being one of the main problems. But the network is rather dense and continuous, and there's relatively few obstacles which bikes or wheelchairs are expected to magically teleport through along the way, which may not always be the case in older cycling towns. With the infrastructure being here to make Taman Jurong a more livable estate, it is now up to more people to use them. While imperfect, let's not let perfect be the enemy of good. If you are a resident here, do give it a try sometimes. The time savings as opposed to waiting for a bus can be significant, especially during off-peak hours. Now, just one last issue that's noteworthy here. This last intersection here, which was widened a decade back, is a huge one. And nowadays, we are seeing traffic lights being installed on the slip lanes to give more times for motorists to make their crossings. So crossing a single road now takes 3 traffic lights for pedestrians. Not good. Naturally, it is human instinct to ignore traffic lights across narrow carriageways, since nobody wants to spend a longer than necessary time under the sun in hot and humid Singapore. Combined with the driver's expectation that green means go, you see them speeding through at really high speeds compared to if these slip lanes were having zebra crossings. That could be very dangerous for an intersection that sees a lot of walkers being right next to a MRT station. And just like that, I'm coming to the end of this episode of Cycling Tours. Do let us know what you think about the cycling network here and give us your thoughts on the format of this video series. It's early days, so you can expect changes as I refine it over the next few episodes. If you are new here, do remember to subscribe and hit the notification bell to be notified of new videos. You can also support me using the Super Thanks function of YouTube. This is Transit Evolution, signing off.